Now, as we all know, Minecraft 1.17 just released, and with this update, we got so many really cool features. And in this video, I'm going to be going throughout a world that I put together which shows off my favorite features from the update. And in the comments, please tell me of your favorite feature from the Caves Eclipse 1.17 update. Let's get right into the video. Now, the first feature that's a personal favorite of mine has got to be the Amethyst Geodes. Now, Amethyst Geodes, they can be found anywhere under the ground, but they're going to be quite tricky to actually locate. So the best way I think that you can probably find these is if you go across like a body of water, like an ocean or a lake. They are actually quite easy to actually seek out. But these are going to consist of a few different blocks. What you're going to be looking for, you're going to be looking for either this black, which is called smooth basalt. You can also get smooth salt if you smelt out basalt from the nether. Then there is calcite. Calcite is a really cool looking block. It's kind of like diorite, but a little bit cleaner and looks so much better than diorite. And then we have results, the main stuff, which is the amethyst. Inside the amethyst geodes, we have all the buds. Now what you're going to be looking for is this big bud, which is called the amethyst cluster. If you have fortune or you just break it with your hand, this object, which is called a shard. So the best way I actually found breaking these is just to use fortune 3, because if you just go in and break it with your fist, then you're only going to get 2 at a time. So if I go and break this with this fortune pickaxe, then we can get up to 16 at a time. This time, I got actually quite lucky, and I got them all at once. But if you were to break it with just your hand, as I mentioned, you'll only get 2 at a time. So make sure that you use fortune 3 if you want to get the most out of your cluster. Now, anyways, for the shard itself, you can also use that to make yourself 2 objects. The first one is the spyglass, and then the other one is the tinted glass. And this is going to talk about my next favorite feature, which has got to be the spyglass. The reason why I love the spyglass so much, because this is going to be very useful for spotting things from afar. Now, over on Java Edition, this won't be very useful because obviously they have the Optifine mod, which has zoom built in. But on Bedrock Edition, we currently do not have anything like that. So if I go ahead and use spyglass on Bedrock, this is going to be kind of like Optifine. But I'm going to simply interact, and now as you can see, I am zooming in and I can see things from really far away. Now to craft it, it's using 2 copper ingots and 1 amethyst shard right on top. Now tinted glass, what it's supposed to do, it basically blocks out light from a certain area. So as you can see, I myself lights on the surface right here. And if I go and set it to nighttime, then no light is going to be coming through this glass. And so our dungeon that I made here, it's going to be completely dark. So it's going to be very good for keeping light out of your mob farms, which is probably going to be the main purpose that people are using it for. Because a lot of people, they absolutely hate the fact that whenever they use regular glass on their mob farms, they have to worry about the light getting into the farms. And so with this, you no longer have to worry about that. And to craft it, it's using 1 piece of glass with 4 amethyst shards on the sides. Our next feature is going to be the glow squid. Now, the reason why I included the glow squid is because they're really good for being killed. Yep, I absolutely love killing glow squid. And they're going to end up giving you a really nice drop, which is called the Glow Ink Sack. And while this may seem like another ink sack, it is definitely not another ink sack. The first thing that you can use this for is making your text brighter on your signs. And I absolutely love the look of this. Now if you're playing on 1.17's release right now, then it's just going to make the text a little bit brighter with the color. But however, on the betas and on 1.17.10, which is going to be releasing quite soon, it's going to give you the nice bright color with a nice overlay in the background, which I absolutely do love. If you want to get rid of the glowing effect, simply interact with the sign with a regular ink sack, and then that brightness will go away. Now you can also make the glow item frame. So if I create myself a regular item frame, and I go and put it right there, and I go ahead and stick down an ink sack right there, then we now got ourselves our glow item frame, which makes items and even maps inside of them a lot brighter. So it's going to be very good in very dark areas. Axolotls are absolutely amazing inside the game because they are actually able to defend you from mobs such as drowns, guardians, or elder guardians. So I think a lot of people will probably be using these on their big ocean adventures. And they can come in different colors as well. There is yellow, pink, cyan, and brown. But however, there is another variant of them which is extremely rare, and it is called the blue axolotl. Whenever you breed 2 axolotls together, then you have a chance of getting a dark blue version of them, which look absolutely incredible, and I love them a whole lot. But the problem is, they are incredibly rare. Like, you can breed like thousands and hundreds of axolotls, and you still will not end up getting yourself one of these mobs. So the blue axolotls, they are really cool, but also just extremely rare. But however, as I mentioned, they can also fight off different mobs. Not only can they fight off the hostile underwater mobs, but they can also fight off the passive ones too, such as glow squids, squids, pufferfish, cod, and even tropical fish. But you won't have to worry about them killing off dolphins or sea turtles. They're absolutely safe. But if I come inside of here and I start placing lots of fish, the axolotls, they are going to go to town. They're going to go feed on the fish, and they're just going to have some good old times. Yet again, we ourselves are pufferfish. And the cool thing is that the axolotls, they do not get poisoned by them. And they may also guard ourselves some glow squids. Get them, get them. Kill the glow squids. Kill the glow squids. And then lastly, we're going to place down some regular squids. And one weird thing is that they actually do not fight the salmon. But next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to switch over to easy mode. And I'm going to place down an elder guardian. As you can see, they're going to go after the elder guardian. We have our regular guardian. And then we also have ourselves some drowns as well. They are now fighting off all these monsters. But the only problem is that it seems like when they're fighting guardians, they do have a little bit of trouble because they do end up fainting a lot. And whenever they are in this fainting position, that's actually them playing dead, and they will regenerate their health until they can come back to battle. And that is a feature that's absolutely incredible. My next favorite feature has got to be all the lush cave blocks, which you got yourself glow berries, you got rooty dirt, you got the wonderful spore blossom, but also moss, and the azalea trees, and even the azalea trees, and also the lovely, and also the drip leaves. All these different blocks are absolutely incredible looking, and I absolutely love them. In 1.18, these blocks will be found in the lush cave biome, so try to keep that in mind. But for the time being, this is how you're going to end up finding them. In the mine shafts, you can find yourself glow berries. You can find moss and shipwrecks from the wandering trader. You can get yourself some rooted dirt, and then bone mill that rooted dirt block in order to get yourself the hanging roots. The spore blossom is actually unobtainable. The only way that you can get it is from creative mode. So if I open up my inventory and I go and look throughout here, there is a spore blossom right there. You can also get yourself some azalea trees and some flowering azalea trees. These are going to be from the moss blocks. So when you bone meal moss blocks, you're able to get yourself some of those blocks, which is really great. But also you get yourself the drip leaf. In order to get the drip leaf, it's going to be from the wandering trader. You go and bone meal that, and then you get yourself the big drip leaf, which whenever you stand on top of that, it will end up falling down after a few seconds, and then after a few more moments, it will go back up. So it's going to be a really good thing for parkour obstacles, and I definitely cannot wait to see what people come up with this block, because there's going to be some really cool parkour designs. Oh, I so can't wait. Now back to the small drip leaf, you can place that on clay blocks, you can place that on dirt, farmland, grass blocks, or possible if they're underwater, but you can also place them on moss blocks as well. And if you want to get yourself these big trees, just bone mill the azalea tree or the flowering azalea tree. Then my next favorite block is dripstone. You can hang this from pretty much any block inside the game. These cannot be hanged from transparent blocks. They can only be hung from solid blocks. But whenever you place lava or water above the block that they're hanging from, then the point it drips down, they're going to start to drip down the lava particles or the water particles. And if you put a cauldron underneath there, then it can fill up the cauldron with either water or lava. And also if you jump on top of these, then you will end up taking FR to damage each jump. So you gotta be careful about that one. But if you land on top of it, then you will also take a large, tremendous amount of fall damage. So please be careful about those. And also make them grow up to 7 blocks high. Or whenever you hang them from a block, they can go all the way down to the ground, about 7 blocks. Whenever you go and break the top block or anywhere on here, then those blocks will start to fall down. So I'm gonna go and break this, and they will also cause damage to you as well. If I go ahead and break this, then the same thing is going to happen. All those blocks are going to fall down. Now, if you want to grow point to dripstone, you need to make sure that you have a water source block above your block of dripstone with the point of dripstone underneath it. Then, if you want to grow it upwards, you need to make sure that there's a block of water within 11 blocks of the dripstone block. And then, you'll be able to grow your very own point of dripstone. But however, if you're underneath the ground, you can also find point of dripstone and blocks of dripstone. If you want to craft blocks of dripstone, it's actually using 4 pointed dripstone. Then you get yourself your very own block of dripstone, and you can go ahead and use this wherever you want. My next favorite feature is deep slate. Now deep slate can come in a variety of blocks. there is a lot of variants that you can get. You can get yourself stair variants, slab variants, and even wall variants for all the corresponding deep slate. But you got cobble deep slate, polished deep slate tiles, and deep slate bricks. And you can also find a variety of ores. If you're underneath the ground in between layer 0 and 16 and 1.17, then you can find yourself the regular deep slate and blobs. And there's also a silverfish variant as well, which is called infested deep slate. And you can also rotate this just like a log. In 1.18, these will generate everywhere below Y0, including the ores as well. You will not find any regular stone below Y0 when 1.18 releases. If you want to end up getting yourself any of the stairs, slabs, or walls, then simply stick the cobble deep slate into a stone cutter, and then you can find yourself all these different blocks. If you want to get the cracked variants for the deep slate bricks or the deep slate tiles, then stick the regular tiles or the regular bricks into a furnace, and then you'll get yourself to crack the variants. And then we also have results the next favorite feature, which is a change to ores, which is something that a lot of people have been wanting for a long time. And that's the ability of making them fortunable. So I'm gonna switch over to game mode S, and we have results two pickaxes. We have a regular pickaxe, and we have a Fortune 3 pickaxe. These are now gonna be able to be used with Fortune 3, which is pretty cool. This will work for copper, will work for gold, and this will work for iron. It works just like normal for the other ores that I used it beforehand. But if I go on and break, this is my Fortune 3 pickaxe, but we only got ourselves one that time. Not the best example, but I'm gonna break that. This time we got a total of 4, so you can get a lot more iron and a lot more gold out of your Fortune pickaxes now. So I'm gonna do the same thing with the gold blocks. I'm gonna go ahead and see how much we get here. Okay, we got 4. And then we have ourselves the new copper blocks as well. I'm gonna go ahead and break these down. And then we have the copper ores. So let's grab our Fortune 3 pickaxe and let's go ahead and break these down and see how many that we get. And we got ourselves 22 out of those 4. That's a lot of copper. And all of these that we collected, we can get one ingot out of all the raw variants, which is really cool. So we got 22 copper ingots, 4 gold ingots, and 8 iron ingots. Definitely a big step up from what it was beforehand. And then we have ourselves some new textures for the ores as well. There's also raw ore blocks that you can get as well. And they all look really cool in my opinion. Definitely gonna be using these for my pathways, especially the iron one. And to get these, you just need to get yourself 9 of the corresponding raw variants. We have ourselves copper. Now, I absolutely love the look of copper. And there is a total of 32 blocks that you can obtain. Now, you can also make the new lightning rod, which is crafted from 3 copper ingots, right down in the middle of the crafting grid. Over time, the copper blocks will start to decay, and which is called oxidation. But if you want to stop it from turning from this orange all the way to this turquoise, then you can simply go ahead and wax it by using a honeycomb. So if I go and interact with this block, then we get these orange particles, and you can do this for all the different variants. Not sure why you would want to do it for the final variant, but if you want to, you know what, that's gonna be an option. You can also do that for the cut variants, and you can also do that for stairs and slabs as well. And you may have also noticed that there's only cut copper variants for the stairs and slabs. And that's because there is no regular copper stairs or slabs. If you want to get yourself to cut copper, then simply stick in any of these variants into a stone cutter, and then you get the corresponding one that you want. Now onto the lightning rod, and this is the reason why it's raining, by the way. If I'm going to stick in some oxidized copper, and I place down the lightning rod, and we should get ourselves a lightning strike. Whenever lightning ends up striking down on the ground, there's a chance that it might end up striking the lightning rod. But if you want to speed up the process, then you can just go ahead and use a trident. And so as you can see, they now went ahead and deoxidized. So we have ourselves the exposed copper. If I go ahead and strike it again, then now we got ourselves a few more changing. Now there is another way that you can deoxidize it, and that's by using an axe. And I interact with one of these, then we got ourselves these white particles. The white particles actually mean that you have de-waxed it. So you can also use an axe to de-wax these blocks to try to keep that in mind. But if I go and interact with these, then they're gonna go back a stage now, because basically just scraping off whatever is on the block. Now as a quick little bonus, I wanna go ahead and include candles, because candles, they are honestly a really cool thing inside the game. They can come in different colors. You can use a flint and steel to go ahead and light them up. So if I place down some candles right here, and then I interact with the flint and steel, then they are now lit. If you want to unlight them, you can interact with them, and then the light will go away. But you gotta make sure that you get yourself in at the end before you can take out the light. You can also put them in cakes, which is also a really cool thing. And you can also light them up again, interact again to go ahead and light them. just like with the regular candles. You can also stack them up to 4, so as you can see we've got ourselves 4 in a row, just like it is for the sea pickles. In order to craft a candle, it's using 1 honeycomb on the bottom with 1 piece of string on top, and then voila, you got yourself your lovely candle. To dye the candle, just grab any color dye that you want, grab your candle, and place that wherever you want on the crafting grid, and then you got yourself your colored candle that you might want. And with that being said, that is it for all of my favorite features for the 1.17 update, and I do want to hear your thoughts down below in the comments on what your favorite feature of this update is, and if you enjoyed this video or found it interesting, then please consider leaving a like on it, subscribe if you're new around here, and don't forget to turn on notifications. For now, I will catch you next time. Goodbye.